Hey folks, Sirdar here. In this episode of Dev with Sirdar, we're going to look at Python's embeddable redistribution. Python's embeddable redistribution is a distribution of Python that's only available for Microsoft Windows. It's delivered as a zip file, which you unpack and run in place, instead of as an installer that you run to formally install Python on a system. Now, the idea behind the embeddable redistribution is that it gives you a portable, self-contained Python runtime that has the absolute minimum of pieces you need to make it functional, such as the standard library. The embeddable redistribution isn't meant to be used as a full replacement for a conventional Python installation. It's for when you want to include a minimal Python runtime with another program, or when you want to perform some tricks that I'm going to talk about in a little bit. So in this directory here, I have listed the unpacked contents of an embeddable version of Python 3.11. It's about 18 megabytes unpacked and about 10 megabytes zipped, so it doesn't have a giant footprint by itself. You would run Python programs with it roughly the same way that you run them regularly. You just run python.exe or pythonw.exe from the command line and then pass in the name of a Python program to run. Now, one of the things that you can do with the embeddable redistribution is you can take a Python program that you've written and make it into a redistributable package. You can make it into something that you can pack up and give to people with a little bit of work. Now, this kind of thing can be tough to pull off, so I don't want to get people's hopes too far up about how far you can go with this. Python programs can be really tricky to make portable because of how dynamic Python code can be. But that said, I have a simple example here which gives you an idea of the process. It's a benchmark that I've used before in other demos, and it employs multiprocessing to paw through this big data file and generate some statistics with it. And in the process of walking through this, I can also use this to talk about some of the other interesting features of the embeddable redistribution. So the code for this consists of a single Python file with a very large data file that goes with it. And I have included both of these in a subdirectory in the distribution. This is to keep the distribution directory itself from getting too cluttered. I also have my program set up to detect where its data files are relative to where this program file is. And this is important because if I package this program in the embeddable distribution, I have to pack the data files with it, and the program cannot make assumptions about where it's running or what directories exist. This is part of why this packing up process can be so tricky. You have to take these kinds of assumptions into account with your program, and many programs aren't written that way to begin with. So to do this with our code, by the way, here's how I did this. We have this thing called the file dunder, which gives us the full path to whatever the current file is. And then I use os.path.dirname to extract the path from that full path. So this tells us where our file is running. And once we have that information, we can figure out where everything else is supposed to be in relation to it. Now, to run this program, I invoke python.exe in the distribution, followed by the path to the program name in the subdirectory. So that's app mpbench.py. And when I run it, that gives us results in about 3 seconds on Python 3.11. This is running on a 12-core machine, and again, the program is using multiprocessing, so the facilities for multiprocessing are included in the redistributable too. Now, if I wanted to make all of this useful by someone else, I could take this command that I just typed, I could turn it into a batch file named runme.bat, I could include it in the embeddable directory, I could zip the whole thing up and just give it to someone else, and they could just unpack it and run it. Now, we would have to make sure that the command that is supplied to run Python invokes this specific executable. We don't want to use the PyLauncher, for instance, because that might invoke the wrong thing, or it might not work at all on a system with no Python installed. So that's the key thing we would have to do here with giving somebody a batch file to run it easily. Now, this also brings me to another limitation of the Python embeddable redistribution. It does not include a native way to install packages into it. It doesn't include pip, the command line utility that installs libraries into Python. That means we can only use what I've described here if we're working with programs that don't have any external dependencies. But a lot of programs have external dependencies. What if I want to use something that employs NumPy or some other library like that? Well, there are a couple of ways to do this. One is to manually install pip in the embeddable using the getpip.py script. This is a totally separate procedure, which I don't recommend for this solution for a couple of reasons. First off, it's not supported in any official way, shape, or form. And two, we don't really want to add pip to the redistributable. All we want to do is install libraries to it in a standardized way. So that brings me to the second solution. This is the one that I favor. We use an existing pip to add packages to the redistributable. In other words, we take a formally installed version of Python that matches the same version that we're running, in this case 3.11. We run pip on the installed version, and we would tell it to install the packages into the embeddable directory. And this is, in fact, a supported process. The way this works requires a couple of steps, but it'll also give us a tour of some of the other useful features worth knowing about with the embeddable. So first thing we'll want to do is have a subdirectory for the installed packages to live in, again, to keep things from getting cluttered. So we'll make a subdirectory and we'll call it site packages. This is the same as what it's called in a full Python installation anyway. So at least it will match the naming there. The embeddable does not have this by default. We have to create this. Now, the other thing is the embeddable does not know that it needs to look in that directory for packages. We have to tell it specifically that packages can be found there. And the embeddable does have a mechanism for this. In the embeddable, we have a file that has this extension, .pth. And what this does is it provides a list of all the paths that the embeddable will look in to find packages. So we just edit this file, add the site packages directory in there at the top, and save it. This zip file listed here, by the way, that's the standard library. It's compressed for convenience because otherwise it would sprawl across quite a few directories. Now, to install something into the site packages directory, we're going to use pip from our main Python installation running 3.11. And to specify the location or the target, we use the T switch. So we install numpy to our embeddable distribution with this command, py-3.11-m-pip install numpy-t, and then the directory we want to install to, which is site packages. And once all of that finishes installing, we can then launch our embedded copy of Python, and we can import numpy directly. And as you can see from this, we now have numpy available. And then we could take this and use a program that we package with it to use numpy as well. Again, you would need to make sure any program you bundle up this way can figure out for itself where it's running and where any data files might be in relation to it. That's the hard part. So to sum up, the embeddable distribution of Python is a Windows-only version of the language that runs standalone in its own directory. It's not a substitute for the full Python installation because it lacks many features of a full Python install, like the pip utility. That said, with some work, you can take your own programs, bundle them with it, and even use another Python installs pip to install third-party packages to it if needed. And the results can then be packed up and distributed to others. And that's it for this episode. If you liked it, leave a comment below. And don't forget to follow Dev with Serdar and InfoWorld on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.